Hey guys, it's Mark Oakley here again with another episode of From the Drawing Board, and it's been a little while, but I thought I'd take a moment to share with a little bit of what I'm up to these days. Hope you're all doing well, and one of the things I like to do when drawing comics, and I've been doing a lot of Thieves and Kings recently, is before a scene starts, and I've got these characters that are going to be, you know, that I'm going to be writing and drawing, and if I haven't drawn them in a long time, then it pays to do some warm-ups. So I like to do pages of sketches of the characters that I'm working with. And you can see here, let's see if I can bring it up here a little tighter. I have this character here, and he hasn't shown up in, gosh, 1,000 pages. And this sketch right here is the last time I drew him. I just redid the sketch, and it's from this book, the green book here. Let's see if I can find the actual page he was on. And this is the Intrepid Thief McGee, and he is a sort of a mythological figure from Nove. And in the Thieves and Kings world, I've divided it into three worlds. One you haven't seen, sort of the underworld. But then there's the main world where everything happens, and it's sort of teeters between a very sort of materialist physical reality and, you know, the fairylands. And so you get kind of get a mix of the both. So you can have magic and technology working together. And then you've got Nove, which is, it's a flat world. It's you know, I described it as being like a giant pizza or a cookie that's really, really big and has dragons that sort of exist around the edges. I'll see if I can find, I did some cool pictures a long time ago. Here we go. Yeah. So that's, I can see that. That was one of my first visualizations of what a dragon should look like. I wanted to make them as big as mountains. And so I told a little fairy tale about the intrepid thief McGee, sort of Rubel's mirror half, his other half, living in this world that's like made of heightened magic. And what would how would a thief manage a dragon problem? Because there was a dragon problem. And so I introduced him to the story. And this right here, it's a little, there it is, down at the bottom left there, is McGee. And I only drew him like two or three times, right? And so I thought, well, he's going to be coming back into the story. He's a very important figure. He's actually, you know, sort of family lineage. He's Rubel's uncle. His sister was Rubel's mom. And, you know, I had all this stuff worked out. I don't think I ever mentioned it. Maybe I might have mentioned it somewhere in the story. I don't think I did. I really don't think I did. Anyway, I figured, okay, it's time to bring him in. Because the story that I'm working on right now is called Apprentices. It's you may have wondered, why is he calling it Apprentices? Well, maybe there's some apprenticeship going on. And Apprentices Part 1, it was all about Serratia and one of her sword maidens and their relationship. And one was sort of the teacher and the other was learning from her. And this particular stretch of story has a lot of characters encountering people who have sort of gone there before and are there to share the wisdom with the characters beneath them. And it pops up and it defines a lot of the relationships. I did it, you know, it's very clear with Quentin and Liana. I brought up a bunch of pages here where I did some sketches. Let's pull that theirs up. Nope, that's a blank one. There we go. So I had to design these two characters, and I've drawn Quentin hundreds and hundreds of times, and but I had to give him a new outfit. So this was my my little scratch page of testing out how these characters would look. So I put them in sort of some dramatic poses and showed the behind of the suit. I didn't go with this this line right here, this white line. Maybe I should have. It looks kind of cool, but I decided to go all black. It has a kind of a neat effect. And then there's Liana. I was figuring out what her outfit would look like. And that's kind of what a sketch page looks like. But I have drawn both of these characters recently, and so I kind of knew what I was, you know, to expect and how to get charisma and character out of their faces. And so I didn't do a lot of drawings. It was mostly just focused on clothing. But with McGee, oh, those are some swordsman. I hadn't drawn him in so long, and I didn't know how his face worked, you know? So, you know, this would be like an early sketch here. Oh, that's not quite what we're after. And McGee was inspired by, you know, when I was like all fantasy authors, when we read Lord of the Rings, I was thinking of Tom Bombadil and that kind of, you know, otherworldly fairy magic. And Tolkien did a lot of that. He had his world that was sort of living close to a reality that we recognized, but they would refer, like, their fairy characters were other. And you kind of got it. You got a sense of it in Lord of the Rings, but it was in some of his little short stories where he was really exploring the concept of fairies. And did he call them fairies? I think he did. Elves? They were elves, but he did refer to them as fairies. And there was a little story called Leaf by Niggle. And I think there was another one, Farmer Giles of Ham, or Farmer Giles of Ham. Don't know which way to pronounce it. And when he wrote those, you got a real sense of this otherness of the fae. You know, like they're beautiful and powerful, and they just overwhelm your senses when you're near them. But he also captured that sense of they're almost too real, or they're hyper real. There's a dreamlike quality, but in waking time. And I found that very inspirational. So there's, you know, Tolkien leading my apprenticeship, right? And that's what I came up with years and years and years ago when I came up with the Intrepid Thief McGee. And I wrote a big, long, you know, poem about him. I thought everything that we do in McGee's world would be kind of done in metered rhyme. And I got pretty good at it. I'm not sure if I'm going to do that with the upcoming text. I haven't quite decided. I think there's nothing quite so cringy as bad rhyming. You know, you'll see it in, you know, fantasy authors will try their hand at it. You're just like, oh, it's these really thudding rhymes, and poetry is very, very hard. And I recognize that. So I tried writing sort of a Dr. Seuss kind of version where the text kind of goes that way. And when McGee steps into the stage, reality warps a little bit. I don't know. I'd like to try it, but I'm perfectly willing to scrap it if it doesn't work, because if you get it right, it sings. It's magical. I can see it working really, really well. But if the pacing is off, if the timing is off, I think it'll just fall flat. I've seen other people try it, and it's so rare when people get it right. And I know what they're after. It's next level writing. We'll see what I can get away with. I've got some pretty good, I've written some stuff which really works for me, but I don't know how you draw it, because one of the problems with metered rhyme is that you use very few words to transmit enormous amounts of data. It's like a compression format for thought. You know, in one sentence, you can make references and allegorical kinds of plays on words, and you're not trying to transmit information through this specific wording, but through the feelings that the words evoke, which is why it's perfect for a character like McGee. But to draw that, they pass really, really quickly, and pace timing is really, really super important in comics. If something reads too quickly, then the reader can move further through the story than the characters do, and so you can see character reactions that are out of sync with the reader's sense of time. It's a little hard to describe, but when you come across a poor example of it, and it's most comics get this wrong. It's very, very hard to do. It's one of the things that I pay strict attention to. And it's one of the reasons I think Thieves and Kings reads as well as I think it does, is that I'm taking care to put myself in the reader's shoes and try and understand their passage through the story and make it sync up with their timing. Yeah, if it goes too quickly, it's rough. And there's a few examples I can talk about, but I'm not going to get into that anyway. But I didn't know how to draw McGee. I had this one little picture, and I couldn't quite figure him out. And so, so I did a bunch of drawings, and I came up with, I think I figured him out. Like these are close right here. It's not quite got the same rough sketchiness, or I wasn't a very good, you know, my penmanship wasn't as refined as it is now. I'm a much more technically skilled artist 20 years later, or however long it's been. And so I have to take that into account. I don't want to overdo that. And so I want to maintain sort of a sketchiness so that the character of Thieves and Kings, it feels the same on page one as it does on page 2000, even though it looks better. And so, you know, I was playing around a little bit and also trying to capture his character. And I picture sort of the guy's made of leather and stone and just cords. So he's super, super tough. And he, you know, uses words like egad, you know, doesn't take any bluster, and he's all about the fisticuffs. He's sort of rebel, but not as soft around the edges. Like he's super, he can take out dragons that are the size of mountains. And in that particular story, did it all through force of character and will. He told the dragon, stop what you're doing. And the dragon was like, yes, sir, you know. And when you can, you know, wrap up a conflict with just that kind of activity, then you can see some real power. Although I do want to actually show him in some combat. This is what a thief looks like in Nov. And so I, you know, drew a few. I've got this big mustache thing happening here. And you can see that I was, you know, I was trying to draw a mustache that was curly, but also actually looked like a mustache. In my early versions, it was just like a, let's see. It was just this sort of thing here. It was just like, I don't really know what a mustache looks like. I'll just put that on his lip and see what we get. So that was me working with McGee. Now, because he's a thief, he's also got a little winged companion. Now, Rubel has Varkias, a little imp. And he has a fairy, like an actual, you know, Tinkerbell-style fairy. And I was trying to work out how to do this. And in the book, she's a little naked girl who's got long, you know, I guess blonde hair. It's black and white. And I was like, well, I don't want to draw her again. She had a look that was very similar to a lot of the women that I draw in Thieves and Kings. And plus she's naked. And so I was like, you know, if she's just a thumbnail, that's not a problem. I don't have a problem with that, but I kind of want to keep the same level of PG-13-ness, I guess, of Thieves and Kings steady throughout the whole story. So I said, okay, I'll put her in a little fairy outfit. So I spent time worrying about this. And I was like, oh, I should stick true there. You know, fairies are naked. I'm going, Mark, you drawn a lot of women, and some of them are really, really quite sleek and pretty, and I'm really good at drawing them now. Like, what? No. Put her in a skirt, fool. And so I did. And this is the character I came up with. And I came up with new hair, but I was like, I really like her big fuzzy floppy hair. And I wanted to give her sort of big feet that are a little bit bigger than, she's a little awkward looking. But I think she's going to be fun. But I had to come up with a reason for, well, why is she a different girl? Why is she a different person? And I thought, okay, well, in McGee's world, fairies have a relationship with the thief. And I thought, well, it's kind of like an office. Fairies don't live forever. In fact, I decided that they live relatively short lives. These little fairies might live 3 years or 5 years. I haven't quite decided that yet. But the position of being McGee's fairy is, it's an important one. And in the fairy world, you know, you don't have tryouts. Maybe it's a family lineage thing, but like not everyone, you know, everyone's, oh, you get to be McGee's fairy. You're his conscience. You're the guy, you're the fairy who sort of keeps, you're the female half of that equation that balances him. Because when he doesn't have a fairy, oh, that was a really bad, there's a whole story about, you know, McGee sort of losing sight. He's way too much of a bachelor and what a mess you make. And he makes a mess of like worlds, you know, so you keep him in check. And you can also learn from this powerful, powerful thief. And so that's her job. So I figured, okay, that's a way of replacing. So she's new-ish. And I don't know what her name is yet. I haven't decided that. But I know what she looks like. And I feel like I can get a lot of tell on what her character is going to be like. And I'm not even sure how much screen time I want to give to her. And I'm not sure how she's going to react to Varkias, who is immortal. Like, Varkias has been around for a long, long time, but his memory is only like 3-5 years long that he can, like, easily recall. I think he can dig deeper and have sort of like, oh, yeah, impressions from a long time ago. Remember Quentin from 1,000 years ago? What a dick. You know, like he was so difficult to work with. But so that's going to be interesting to write. I haven't written that yet. I have some vague idea. I have a feeling about it. It's a bouncy future. It's going to be fun to write. And I also decided to, I did some research on fairy wings. Did you know that most fairies that, you know, that are drawn, the little, you know, 8-inch tall, 6-inch tall little girls, they have butterfly wings. And I'm like, or they have no wings. Like Tinkerbell, I don't think she has wings at all. Maybe she does. I haven't checked the Disney version I'm thinking of. I think she can just fly, and that's what the fairy dust is for. But I decided dragonfly wings seem buzzy enough and fast enough so that they can zip around. Like, I've never seen a butterfly zip. They kind of just get buffeted. But I don't know how butterflies manage, to be perfectly honest. They have like these clumsy gliders. They're beautiful, but how they get around or how they can aim or land correctly, it doesn't seem like a good way of getting around. Varkias has those bat wings, which may not be... I've decided to sort of take some liberties with that. Like, he can be very precise in his flying maneuvers, but he's not going to be like this girl who, so I, you know, I pulled up, someone had scanned some actual, or is that a scan or an illustration? Anyway, I found this online. So, okay, that'll be my model. And I strayed from that. I think I'm going to go with a slightly different shape, but it's definitely going to look like, oh, it's a set of, sort of dragonfly wings. So I think that's how she's going to get around. And also just trying to figure out, like, well, where do the wings go when she sits and stops flying? Do they just stick out? It seems like it could be awkward. Like, how do you get through a door or, you know, a small space? Maybe they fold back. Got to come up with some rules for that. Anyway, this was like a fun, spent an afternoon just figuring out what these characters look like and how they interact. This happens a little later. The next scene that I actually have to work on involves the Prince Guard. So I had to refamiliarize myself with these guys. And I have this really neat combat scene. Rubel and the guards are going to face off. And it's I wrote this really, really fun piece of it's a neat scene with some good dialogue and some good action in it. And it builds into, well, you'll see how it works. It doesn't all... You'll see. Anyway, I had to figure out, you know, what do these guards look like? And so I came up with sort of various characters for each of them. I'm not sure if I'm going to use this guy here. He's sort of got that captain look, and I changed his uniform a little bit. He looks like a sort of a tough guard captain. And then I kind of played with this dude here. You know, how do these hats work? I like the way they sort of fold right over the top of the head, and kind of gave him, all right, I think he'll figure in the story a bit. So I worked out kind of how he works. Does he have a round chin, the sort of no chin, a little bit more square here? How do we do it? So this was just some stuff that I was working on. I thought I'd share. And what else do we have? Let's see. Well, that was just the closing sequence with the Lockheimer and Beast Monster Number 2. I'm not sure she has a name. I didn't name her. I just called her Creature all throughout this little scene. But she's kind of the weapon that's going to be deployed against Quentin. And we'll see how that plays out. And I didn't really show off what her powers are, although you get the sense she's sort of weirdly elongated and she can kind of change size a little bit. Like, and she can be, I tried to get sort of her weird perception of reality expressed in this scene where you're sort of, oh, I'm talking to a woman, but I'm not really talking to a woman. She sort of moves like an animal and kind of crouches and does odd things. And I brought this thing up too. It's getting really, really tight. This is how Lockheimer controls the evil sisters, of which Serratia was like the perfect example. These three were like the rejects, but they're enormously powerful. Probably not as powerful as Serratia, but much more controllable, as we'll see. Anyway, so she has these little pendants that take, like, I guess, I have a whole sort of idea for how these work. Like, this is a little piece of like the seed of what one of these creatures is, and you sort of use magic to sort of bilocate. So this would be like an early version of her, a piece of her biology in its most vulnerable forming, you know, capacity. And it's in a little necklace that that Lochiemyr controls. So that's how she maintains her leash on these monsters. But anyway, that's a whole other scene. And then I've got this blank page here. So I have a scene where Rubel and these guardsmen encounter one another, and I've got to decide what that's going to look like. And how long have we been going here? Probably long enough. I don't think I'll do any drawing for now. I just wanted to get caught up on those. Maybe I'll do another little video where I'll show you some of the design work that I have in mind for the scene where those guards and Rubel encounter one another. In fact, what I probably really need to do, I haven't drawn Rubel in quite a while. I think it might be worth doing a page of Rubel's. Maybe I'll do one of those right now. Let's see if I can remember what he looks like. Because I feel like I know I haven't focused very much on the principal character in Thieves and Kings. I've been focusing on all these other characters that I've really invested some energy and awareness into who they are and how they work. But Rubel's our boy, man. We gotta give him some love. And the last scene that he was in, it wasn't really about him again, and he was not in his element. He had too much free time, and he was kind of making mistakes and kind of joking, but I didn't let him express the essence of his character, which is kind of trusting wonder in the world, but power, and working with this strong palette of emotions and a strong desire to figure out what his place in the world is. He knows he wants to be a good thief, and he knows he wants to take care and love his friends, and he's going to do it through adventure and doing, you know, feats of thiefiness. And I feel like, you know, we have all known him really, really well, but it's important to revisit. And so I spent a lot of time working on that piece of scripting to try and really capture what he is, but not as a caricature. I found that that's what it was. The last scene I did, I felt like I was not expressing him so much as expressing the caricature of what his pattern is. So Rubel is all about these things, and just tossing him in there, as opposed to really trying to get into his head and understand him and feel for him and feel through him, so that I want him to be real. And so it's time to give Rubel some of that, you know, writerly love. I want him to want his character to sing once again. And so that's been a really an interesting challenge. So that's kind of what this is about. So let's just do a Rubel. And it's actually a very appropriate time to be thinking that way, because he's going to be meeting his uncle. And he didn't even know that he had an uncle. And so there's some story about his parentage and sort of what family is for him directly, and what it means to be a thief. Because he's going to be meeting the archetype, the major arcana of thiefness. The intrepid thief McGee is one of these immortal characters who, you know, it's best to capture his reality through rhyme and through poems, because he's just too much to be contained in the boring, real, material kind of world. And so Rubel has to learn a little bit more about that as he also increases in his power. All the characters are getting much more powerful. I've made that's an important part of the story, which I haven't really described. I find I'll come up with explanations for why things work, but I don't tell anybody. I just sort of write the results. I do the whole show don't tell, and I do it very, very naturally. I tend to, anyway. And I'll realize, oh, I've never explained how that works. Well, it might be time for some explanation. In Jenny Mysterious, I did a lot of info dump kind of scenes, and I was like, okay, well, that was sort of appropriate for what I had in mind for that story. But for this story, I want it to be more about the flow, and so I don't want to overburden readers with too much exposition. All right, let's give him sort of a nice hero pose here. I find when I draw stuff, I often have them a little off axis or a little off, like gravity isn't favoring them. So I tend to, I'll do the drawing and then grab the whole thing and just kind of twist it a few degrees just to sort of make them line up with the ground correctly. Yeah, even his boots, I have to say, oh yeah, how did I draw those? Was there one of these things? Was this lip part higher or lower? Does he change his shoes? I think he's going to have the same set of boots as he's had for much of the story. I don't think he's gotten a new pair anytime recently. There we are. I really enjoy drawing feet. Yeah, those look a little awkward there, but this is my first drawing of the day. So, okay, let's do that thing I was describing. Oops, that's not what we wanted to do. This is what we wanted to do. This one. There. Just turn it a little bit and he isn't tipping over anymore. Okay, let's do another one here. Let's do one where he's a little bit more thoughtful. Because he's in a very interesting situation in his life right now. Like, he's living in this tower that he built. Didn't take him very long to build it. That's sort of his mystical, magical thief qualities coming through. But he's also the kind of guy who cares about how other people feel. Now, I was looking at Peter Pan. I read Peter and Wendy recently, and or a version of it. And I love the way Peter is represented. Like, who wrote that? I can't remember the author's name, I'm sorry, but I love the way Peter was represented. He was such a boy, so, you know, he's such a narcissist. He thought about his own adventure and his own greatness, and he talked about it a lot. And there was something that it just drove you nuts if you were his friend. He's like, you're going, oh man, it's dangerous to be around this guy. He's just too powerful. And, you know, the women in his life loved him for it and were driven nuts by it at the same time, but it was appropriate for that character because he was another archetype, these sort of gods in human form. And I wanted to give Rubel a little bit of that, or some of it, because that's kind of what it means to be a thief. You recognize that you're a hero, but he also does live in that real world. And so if he does hurt somebody or hurt somebody's feelings, he's going to be aware of that and he's going to want to not do that. And so I make him a little bit contemplative at the same time. So he's an interesting balance of, it doesn't work. You know, who's the real boy and who's the brash adventurer, and how much of each is the correct mix? And honestly, for someone his age, because he's just a kid, I guess he's about 15 or 16 now. Yes, he's a magical character and he does have a strong spirit and tries to do the right thing, but he's still very, very young and hasn't worked out precisely who he is yet. So he doesn't necessarily have the correct answers to these things. I remember what it was like to be that age myself. And yeah, you've got your personality, which is there, but you're buffeted around by strong emotions. And, you know, one month you might be a little, you know, significantly different and reactive in ways that will be different a year later, right? And so this would be his journey, which, and again, it's appropriate for the apprentice's story. So he's going to be figuring this stuff out. Figuring out his family, his lineage, kind of who he is, what his responsibilities are, how to grow up, you know, what's he going to be like when he's a man? Because he's sort of on the threshold of manhood, and he's got, you know, he's living with a girlfriend really too, and So there's a lot of responsibilities there. Let's see here, does that work? That mouth doesn't quite do it. And neither does that. You can play forever with these mouths. That doesn't look like a Rubel face. Doesn't work. Yeah, this is very, very important. Isn't it funny that the character, the principal character, is the one that I'm having to really think about here? The other ones are neat because I'm inventing them as I go. And Quentin is he's nothing but caricature. I mean, there's a person there, but his whole story is there. He is. He looks nice there. There we are. And Leanna, I explored her character a little bit, but I'm still inventing her. So when you're inventing someone, it's like you're discovering them for the first time. And as such, when you write them, that exploration is very, very honest and earnest. With Rubel, though, we already know who he is. And so I have to tap into a different kind of discovery process to... to really know who he is. There we go. And I'm also drawing differently too. I have, like I said, I have sort of more skill at my disposal, and so more details are showing up in the line work, and they allow me to a greater range of expression, as opposed to the lines themselves, the crudeness of the lines doing a bunch of that expression unconsciously on my behalf. So as you have more skill, I'm doing it with more, you know, intention that's coming deliberately for me. And so now I can't just rely on my inner brain to give me all the answers. I've got to understand him. And so in a way, I'm also apprenticing sort of to myself or to my expanded skill set. And so I have to learn also. But that's great, because if you're not learning, at least for me, I find things just stagnate. Even if you're really, really good at stuff, if you're not tackling a problem that you don't quite, you're just on the edge of mastering, you're not present. Because you can, if you're really, really good at something, you can kind of fall asleep while you're doing it. And then you get this quality that, I think that comes across. I think the stuff that's difficult for the artist to do is often, while it looks a little bit more crude and unpolished, has so much life to it. You see this with so many different artists. And so I've got to bridge that gap. I've got to learn how to be present. There he is. Hey, Rubel. How's it going, man? And let's put Varkias on his shoulder here. I think I'll put him on this side. I wonder if I have to revisit Varkias. I've been drawing him a lot. He's much easier. He's a very simple character. But that's also sort of Varkias's role, is that it's not that complicated. He does have a backstory, and it's probably, and I've published some stuff where we learn a little bit about where he came from. And it's a sad little story, but it's also beautiful. I'm going to have to visit that correctly and give him the proper closure, or what do you call it? Don't want to call it, calling it an arc is so, what does that mean exactly? It's like a half a circle, a piece of a circle. I'll explore him more fully so that we can know who and what Varkias is all about. And that might be an appropriate time to sort of get into that when McGee shows up, because I can see a good, it being a good opportunity, you know, comparing notes with his professional counterpart, that fairy, you know, where is she? Like, how is she going to react to meeting Varkias? I don't know. And also, fairies reproduce. Like, they have sexuality. They, you know, but Varkias is an immortal. He's weird. He has no reproductive organs. So how do you fit those two things together, literally and figuratively? And do you? I don't know. That's going to be an interesting piece to write. I'm going to have to it's going to be a challenge. It's going to be a challenge, one that I'm looking forward to. Anyway, that's probably enough for today. I'd like to thank you for joining me in this little sketch time and this little sharing of pictures. I hope you're all doing well, wherever you are, day or night. Tune in again, and we'll do some more comics together. All right, take care, everybody.